lords. O Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you. I will praise your name for what you have done. Wonderful things, planned, formed of old, faithful and sure. This is where worship starts. Here in the temple.
Church, welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Lynn. I'm from the Elgin campus. I just am so glad to be able to be the one to say thanks for coming. We're so glad that you're joining us today. If this is your first time, a special shout out to you. We're so glad that you've landed with us. In fact, we would love to know where you're watching from. If you could put that in the chat or the comment section, we would really appreciate that. Well, if you're new, whether you're new or whether you've been here for forever like me, would you just take a second and check in? It's really helpful for us to know that you're here. You can do that right on your Harvest app on your phone, or you can do that in the comment section, a link in the YouTube or Facebook, right where you're watching from. We'd also love if you put down a prayer request. We find it a real honor to be praying for you through the week. Well, if you're not a guest, this announcement's for you. We just want to help you continue your worship through giving. So here are the ways that you can do that. You can give right on the Harvest website. In fact, if you take your phone camera, you put it right up to that QR code on the screen, it'll link you automatically right to the giving page. Or you can just give through your app, you can give through a text, or you can send in your gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. Thank you so much for each and every gift. Well, young adults, oh my goodness, things are really happening in the young adult ministry, and I've got a couple things to tell you about. I want to make sure that you all know that you're invited to the next monthly gathering. It's actually coming up this week on Thursday, April 22nd. It's at 6:30 at the Rolling Meadows campus, and there's going to be worship and some teaching from the Word and a chance for you to meet other young adults. So we hope that you can join us. And then I'm really excited to tell you that there's going to be a young adult retreat up at Camp Harvest. It's going to be on Memorial Day weekend. And what an opportunity to come and meet some more people. We're praying that you will really encounter the God who loves you, and all the other fun camp stuff will be available too. So we pray that you check out harvestnow.info for all of the information. Well, if you're a parent and you have a child between the ages of, say, preschool all the way up through 11th grade, this video might be really interesting to you. So take a look, would you?
Hi, Harvest. My name is Talbot Benkin. I'm the superintendent at Harvest Christian Academy. Parents of school-aged children, are you wondering about the progress that your students made in the past years, especially with reading and math, with it being such a unique year for everybody educationally? Well, if so, we'd like to try to help you. We're a ministry of the church, and we want to bless our church, and so we'd like to invite you to HCA on April 24th. We're going to have an assessment where we assess your student in reading and math using our nationally normed assessment here at our school. And we want to provide that to you just as a blessing. And we'd like to invite you to come and join us. I will say, we do have a limited number of seats, so the earlier you can sign up, the better. And we hope to see you on April 24th.
Well, we're praying that Harvest Christian Academy might be a blessing for your family as well. So if you want more information, check out harvestchristianacademy.org. Well, I'm happy to tell you that Dr. Rydelnik is back today. He's continuing his series in the book of Ephesians. I love this book. He's going to be in chapter 2, focusing on the first 10 verses. So why don't you go grab your Bible, and we're going to get to worship right after we pray. Would you join me in prayer? Almighty Heavenly Father, man, you have blessed us so much with an eternal portfolio that is unbelievable. Nothing that we deserve and everything that blesses us. So thank you, Lord, for this study of Ephesians. I pray that you would help us to really lean in, to listen closely to the Spirit of God. We want so much to be changed by your word today. So Father, we ask that you would bless this time in Jesus' name.
We're welcomed by God today. When you're in Christ Jesus, He is 100% for you. You are under His grace. Come on, let's get these hands clapping. Let's give God worship.
Oceans of kindness, wave after wave, mercy arriving again and again. Love will find us, you're never far away.
He's in the room today.
Battles behind us, battles ahead. God, you are for us, what stands against? We have this promise, you're never far away.
Yeah. Come on, lift it up.
We've seen your faithfulness in the darkest night. We've seen your goodness, God, your favor on our lives. Everywhere we go, your grace is on our side. Your grace is on our side. Your grace is on our side. Battles behind us, battles
grace is on our side. We've seen what you can do.
Things are
stronghold will crumble and we'll hear chains hit the ground. Oh God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Yes, God. We pray for revival, but only Jesus can bring revival. That's right. We pray for revival in this city, in our church, in our families, but we have to know that only Jesus can bring revival, because Jesus is the light that came into the darkness and the darkness could not overcome him. So we pray with the psalmist in Psalm 85, would you not revive us again so that your people may rejoice in you? Show us your steadfast love and bring us your salvation. That is what we pray, because we know that only the Lamb that was slain for us can do that. So God, we pray, bring revival here. Would you pour it out? The darkest night, you can light it up. Yes, you can light it up. You're the God of revival.
Sing it to him.
Let hope arise. Death is overcome. Yes, you've already won. Because you're the God of revival. So revive us again, God.
Only Jesus can bring revival. He's light of the world, the hope for us. Come on, let's sing to him this morning.
See him there, the great I am, a crown of thorns upon his head, and the Father's heart displayed for us. Oh God, we thank you for the cross.
Hallelujah to your holy name, Jesus, you. will see your face, bright as the sun, and we'll bow before, oh, the King of Kings, oh God, forever we will sing.
Come on, lift up your song to the Lord today, the King of Kings.
Behold.
Of all humanity and arose from the dead. There's no other religion like it. There's no other God that's alive today, that's seated at the right hand of power and reigning. It's that name. It's the name we sing, the name that's worthy of all praise. And one day, every knee is gonna bow and every tongue is going to confess. But we have an opportunity to bow the knee right now to confess that Jesus is Lord.
And I exalt thee.
Come on, lift it up.
And I exalt thee,
Jesus.
And I exalt thee, O Lord.
Come on, lift it up to him.
And I exalt thee,
only Jesus. God, this is your praise. This is for your name alone. God, we give you worship. We give you adoration. We love your name, Jesus. We thank you for all you've done. You reign above it all. You shine light into our darkness. You are the hope of the world. That one name, and that name alone, has power to save. And it's the name that we proclaim in this place and that we lift up. Jesus, Jesus, that name alone. In that name that we pray. Amen. Church, you may be seated.
Hey, can we do something for me? Can we kind of turn these lights back a little bit? Oh, thank you. And could you turn those lights up a little bit so people can see their Bibles? Hey, great, thank you. Huh. I was blinded as I came up here. I thought I was on the road to Damascus. It's great to be with you. And greetings to not just all of you folks here at Elgin, but across all our campuses. It's wonderful to be with you this morning. So glad to be here. I've got great news. You say, what news has he possibly got? It's not the good news. We'll talk about that in a second. But Israel announced this week that they're opening up for tour groups again. May 23rd. That's kind of cool because we have scheduled a Harvest Bible Chapel tour to Israel in October of 2022. So many of the restrictions that are even going to be used, I believe, with tour groups now will be gone by then, but it is possible, it is open, and the way to find out about that trip is on the Harvest website. You can go there and there are links, and you can even register already. We have a few registrants who, you know, somehow found out about this trip, and so don't miss out. You're going to go with Dr. Michael Van Lanningham. Dr. V is a lot of fun, and I'll be there too, but the most important person is Eva will be there, my wife, and she's the most fun. But the thing is, one year we were in Israel together, Mike V and I, leading a tour to Israel, and it was pouring rain at the Garden of Gethsemane, and there was like no way in the world anyone was getting out of that bus. And we had about three buses. We have these headsets where you can hear what's being said in a microphone, wireless. And so we had everyone put on their headsets, and then Mike V went out and stood in the pouring rain and taught us the word about Gethsemane. And I just thought that's the guy you want to go to Israel with, who will stand there drenched in rain, teaching the word in season, out of season. He is a wonderful teacher. He's going to be there. I'll be there teaching. So it'll be either Mike V or I will be teaching at every site. So learn the word on site. It's just a great experience. So anyway, you can find it on the Harvest Bible Chapel website. Okay, let me tell you about my favorite scene from all the movies. This is like my number one favorite movie is The Princess Bride. And my favorite scene in The Princess Bride is Miracle Max, when they bring Wesley How many have never seen the never ever have seen The Princess Bride? Wait. Everyone look at these people with their hands up. And give them a little shame. Come on. A little. You gotta go home and watch The Princess Bride. But they bring Wesley, the hero of the story, to Miracle Max, who's played by Billy Crystal, and his wife Valerie, played by Carol Kane. And they decide that he's dead. What are they gonna do? They need a miracle. And so Miracle Max gives him, well, he says he's gonna give him this miracle pill, chocolate coated, stay out of the water for a half hour afterwards. But he says, you can do something, they ask him. And Miracle Max says, he's only mostly dead. He's not all dead. There's a difference between mostly dead and all dead. And he says, I've seen Moise. So I love that scene where they jam the chocolate miracle pill down the throat of Wesley and he comes alive. And I love also when Andre the Giant says of him, he's been mostly dead all day. I think that it gets better. The reason I thought of that is when I look at Ephesians 2, which we're going to look at today, Ephesians 2, 1 through 10, it's talking about how God brought us from death to life, okay? From death to life. And I just want to be really clear. When it talks about our spiritual condition before we knew the Lord, we were not mostly dead. We were all dead. That there was no hope of a miracle with a Miracle Max. The only hope we had was for the God of the universe to raise us and revive us. That's the only hope we had. And that's what we're gonna talk about today. So what I wanna do is look at how God didn't give us a miracle pill, but he gave us the Messiah who saved us and took us from death to life. That's what we're gonna look at today. Now let's remember where we are at. We're studying our eternal portfolio. That's what the book of Ephesians. We have to live in light of our eternal portfolio. The first three chapters lays out our bank account, basically, our portfolio. And then the next three chapters tell us to live in light of that portfolio. But the first three chapters kind of detail it, and we see all our wealth. We see that we have the riches of redemption in chapter one. And now we're going to see that we have the riches of regeneration, being made alive in chapter 2, 1 through 10. Then we're going to look later at the riches of reconciliation in 2, 11 through 22. And then the riches of God's revelation to us in chapter 3. So we've got a plan when we look at our wealth. Today we're looking at the riches of his regeneration in our lives. Now, in the beginning part, we're going to look at our past condition. That's where we're going to start. And then we're going to look at our new position. But our past condition is we were dead in sin. Before I even go further, I'm already jumping in. But what I'd like to do is have us read this text, Ephesians 2, 1 through 10. So why don't we stand in honor of God's word, and I'll read, you follow along. Get out your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 2. And follow along as I read. And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, like the rest of mankind. But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in the Messiah Jesus, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Messiah Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Messiah Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. You can have a seat. So our past condition, verses 1 through 3, describes that we were dead in sin. Verse 1 is pretty plain. It says in verse 1 that you were dead. You were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked. We were dead. What does it mean to be dead? Well, we all know dead is dead. It's not mostly dead, it's all dead. But really, the best definition of the word dead that I could give you is separation. So, for example, when we die physically, our physical part, our material part, separates from our immaterial part, and we become the physical part goes to the grave, or what other people do with it, whatever happens. But the immaterial part, the spirit, the soul, that, if we know the Lord, goes to be with the Lord. So that's physical death. Spiritual death, which is what Paul is talking about here, is when, because of our trespasses and sins, we are now separated, there's that word again, from God. God created us to have a relationship with him, but our sins, walking in trespasses and sins, separates us from God. A trespass is a false step, a blunder, a wrong turn. How many have made those? Anybody? Come on, admit it. Not me. No, I have. And you know what? I still do. And a sin is the word for missing the mark. It was used of shooting an arrow and missing the mark, or throwing a sling and missing the mark. That's the idea. Not hitting the target. We have a target of obedience and we fail. So that makes us separated from God. We were dead. Secondly, we were disobedient. And I want you to look at these verses here. It says, the trespass and sins in which we once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in us, and the sons of disobedience. Isn't that a great title for what we are, the sons of disobedience? That almost sounds like a HBO TV show or something. The sons of disobedience. That's the story of our lives. Anyway, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body or the flesh and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath. Okay, so look at the three. Why were we engaged in this deadly behavior, separated from God? Because we were disobedient. And why were we disobedient? Because we were following the world, the devil, and the flesh. Those are the three battlegrounds of all people. The world, that's what he says here. You followed the course of the world. The world is a system that we all live in, organized by Satan and opposed to God. That's what the world system is. And that's what we're getting. And we can see us getting that all the time. The world system, so often people think, what is worldliness? Worldliness is going to movies or, you know, something like, no. Worldliness is following the system, the philosophy of life, the meaning of life as it's taught, and it's organized by Satan and it's opposed to God. That's the world. That's one of the reasons why we're disobedient, because we're going with the flow, so to speak, of what's around us. And then the second enemy of the believer, the second enemy of any person, is the devil, the leader of the great rebellion against God. He is the opposition party to God. He leads it. And he is the one that he's called here the prince of the power of the air, right? That's why the prince of the power of the air. I think in Jewish thought, the air was the abode of demons. You can see that in rabbinic theology. And he is the leader, the ruler, the prince of all these powers. They rebelled against God before time. He cast them out. He caused Adam and Eve to sin. He led us into destruction. I love how he is called in the book, the Screwtape Letters. The demon in there calls him our Father below. That's what captures it. We who know the Lord Jesus have our Father in heaven, our Father above. The enemy, they have the Father below, those demons, that's what they call him. He is the leader of the opposition party, and he tempts us. You know, I do think that sometimes we have to be careful about Satan, because I have a lot of people that talk to me, and they're always thinking, oh, Satan did this, and Satan did that. I think we're really capable of a lot of stuff without Satan, and people get really caught up in this, and they get too caught up in it. And they're casting demons out left and right. You know, when in doubt, cast it out. And they see a demon under every rock. And then other people become so naturalistic. We think, oh, it's just us. There really is no enemy. There really is an enemy. So much of the evil we see in the world, I mean, there really is a prince of darkness. And he is leading these demons who are influencing people. So I do think we need to get a balance. Our focus should not be on Satan. Our focus should be on the Lord Jesus who redeemed us. That's what Jesus says in Luke 10 when the disciples came back and saying, hey, man, this is so cool. Even the demons listen when we cast them out. And Jesus says to them, don't rejoice that the... He said, I've given you authority, but don't rejoice in the authority you have over demons. Instead, rejoice that your names are written in the book of life. That's where our focus should be. So I like what C.S. Lewis says about thinking about Satan. He says there are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils, about demons. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. That's what I see, two extremes. They themselves are equally pleased by both errors and hail a materialist or a magician with the same delight. What they don't want us to do is focus on our Redeemer. And that's what we need to do. But here it's saying, why were we disobedient? Because we followed the course of this world. We were influenced by the prince of demons, the enemy party, the opposition to God. And then the third reason is, and this comes from within us, the flesh. That's the third great enemy of the believer. It says that we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the flesh in the body and the mind. The flesh refers to our inherent sin nature, our desire to sin, to satisfy ourselves, whether with our mind or our bodies. It's the gratification of both the mental and physical desires that we have. Not saying there has to be boundaries, it's better for me. It's sort of like when I, you know, here's a great example of the flesh. When I see a bagel with cream cheese and lox, and I'm thinking, nah, I really don't need to eat that, especially with the chocolate cake from Portillo's afterwards. I don't need that, but I want that. And I satisfy the desire of the flesh. And I could even become gluttonous, which would be really a sin. The same thing is happening all the time when we carry out those desires. But I want it. It feels good. I like thinking about this. And you know what I'm talking about. That's what makes us do things that we know are in opposition to God. That's how we walk. It's what we are. It's who we are. It is who I am. That's what the flesh is. Now, I have this beautiful dog. We rescued him. His name is Frodo. And he's an oversized Sheltie. He's like a small collie. He's blue merle. He's just beautiful. And he's got a sweet disposition. But one of the things that we discovered when we got this dog is every time we'd leave the house, he would get into the trash and just throw it all over the house. He would take the trash and throw it down the steps into our basement or scatter it over the kitchen. And sometimes we started putting up a gate to keep him from the trash. He would move the gate out of the way and get to the trash. And so then we put a chair to hold the gate in place, the baby gate. And he would move the chair and move the baby gate and get to the trash. He loves the trash. Another time we came home, we had left a closed, sealed can, 2-pound can of blister peanuts from Georgia on our counter. I don't know how this little dog got on the counter, got the can down. I think he worked with our boxer. You get it down, I'll eat it. And we came back and he ate 2 pounds of peanuts. Remember, we clean up after those dogs. I know who ate them. Who ate those peanuts? I had a girl watch him. We went to Israel, so one of my students came to our house and watched him. What did he do? She's working on her computer, and all of a sudden, he was laying there next to her on the floor, chewing the wire that goes from the wall to the computer, and then cut in half. I had to go buy her a new wire for her computer when I got back. Why does he do these things? Well, I think it's because he's reprobate. That's what we call him, the reprobate. He's sweet, he's nice, I really like him. He's gentle with my grandkids, it's great, but he's reprobate. He does these things because he's a dog. And there's other things he does because he's a dog, which I won't even go into. That's what he does because he's a dog. Why do we carry out the desires of the flesh? Why do we gratify the flesh? Why do we sin? Because we're sinners. That's why. That's why we do it. We are doing what comes naturally. That's what happens. And so the truth of it is that we were dead, we were disobedient, and because of that, we were doomed. If you look at chapter 2, verse 3, after it talks about the three great enemies, it says, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. Basically, what this is saying is that we were all destined to face the wrath of God because of this sin. We were destined to face the wrath of God, a just God. We were going to stand before him, and how could we stand? You ever hear this expression? I'm doomed. That's what we were. We were doomed. We were going to stand before it. A just God can't pass it up. He can't overlook sin, and we sin. I was once on a TV show. You may have heard of it. It was called Donahue. How many have ever heard of Donahue? It was a show about people who have left the faith, and they had a few believers on. We were in New York at the time, who were there, who were followers of Jesus. And at one point, Phil comes up to me with his microphone. And, you know, I was an invited guest, but he was making me rely on his microphone. He says, so they're saying, these people who have left the faith, that you're saying that everyone goes to hell. Especially, and you say you're Jewish, you say that all Jewish people are going to hell. And all people are going to hell if they don't believe in Jesus. Is that true, yes or no? I thought, well, I need a little bit of a nuanced answer here, I thought to myself. And so what I said was this. I said, here's what I think. First of all, God has relieved me of my position as Associate Supreme Justice of the world. He's going to make the decision of who goes to heaven and who goes to hell, not me. But I know one day I'm gonna stand before the just judge who is perfectly holy and perfectly righteous. And I know because of my life, because of my behavior, because of the wrong things I have done, I can't stand before him with any confidence. I'm doomed. God sent forth his son. The Bible says that God became a man, the Lord Jesus. He died because of the wrong things I did. He was raised again. And if I trust in him, he will take his righteousness and attach it to me. And then I will be able to stand before the judge. Not because of anything I've done, but because of what he has done. And now I said, everyone's going to have to make that decision. Think about standing before a just and holy God, and you decide whether you're able to do that or not, or if you need Jesus. And that's how I answered the question. He said, why are you fudging? I said, Phil, why are you trying to make me God? And he said, okay, I'll let it go. Then he came back at it at one point. I loved it. I said, Phil, do you even believe in heaven and hell? He said, no. I said, so what are you asking me about this for? So, but that's the point. Every one of us needs to realize that one day we're going to stand before a holy God, and we are by nature children of God's wrath because of our disobedience. The just judge will judge us. We were doomed. Doomed. Well, this seems pretty bleak, but it seems so dark. Why does Paul paint such a bleak picture? Well, I've learned everything just about in life from Mr. Rogers. I was once watching Mr. Rogers, and he took, you know how he goes to the factories and shows people how different things are made? Well, he showed kids on one program how a jeweler shows jewelry, and he takes out a black velvet piece of cloth and lays gold rings on it or lays diamonds on it. You've seen that, haven't you? And the black background shows how magnificent the jewelry is. Well, this is what Paul's doing. This verses 1-3 here, it's the black piece of velvet. It's showing how terrible our situation was before we knew Jesus. And now he's going to put the diamonds and the gold and all that right on it so we can see what he has done for us. To see, it's to make how glorious it is that God has acted on our behalf. It makes it seem even greater. So just remember, he's painting a very bleak picture in verses 1-3, but then he uses verses 4-10 to lay it against that bleak picture to show how glorious it is that God has acted on our behalf. So we're gonna look at verses 4-10. It was bleak. We were dead, but we have a new position. We've been made alive to God. We have a new position. We were made alive to God. Now, how does he do it? I'm going to quickly go through verses 4-10. First of all, God's work made us alive. God's work made us alive. And you can see it here in verses 4-6. God did it through his mercy. God was merciful to us when we deserved judgment. Look at it. It says in verse 4, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us. God is rich in mercy. What does it mean to be merciful? Mercy is this. It's not giving us what we deserve. We deserve judgment. Mercy says, nope, not going to give it to you. Mercy is not giving us what we do deserve. I was, when I first was a pastor, I was living in Columbus, Ohio. I would go on Wednesday nights to the Lutheran seminary where they had a really good library, and I would study for my sermon that weekend. And Eva was home with our son, who was a baby. And one night I came back and I was trying to get back in time for Hill Street Blues. I just wanted to watch Hill Street Blues. And so I'm driving and I turn right onto our side street where we live, off the main street. I pull into the driveway and I see a van come behind me and pull up, and it's got flashing lights. My assumption automatically, it's an ambulance. And I start to step out of my car because I think maybe something happened and Eva called an ambulance because I had the car and she was, but no, it was a police car. It was a police van. And he says, step back into the car, sir. Yes, sir. He comes up to my car in my driveway and he says, you know, you slid through that stop sign on the corner. I said, yeah, I did. And there's another police officer looking in on the other side, you know, hand here. I'm a little nervous. He says, what's the rush, sir? Trying to get home in time to see Hill Street Blues. He says, where are you coming from? Lutheran Seminary. What were you doing there? I was preparing my sermon. They go and they check my license. They see there's no priors on me, and He comes back. He says, we want to get back to the station so we can see Hill Street Blues. So we're not going to give you a ticket, sir. Oh, no, we're not going to give you a ticket, Pastor, he says. He says, but go and sin no more. Do you know what he did? He showed me mercy. It was mercy. I deserved a ticket. He didn't give it to me. We deserve judgment. But God, being rich in mercy, doesn't give it to us. It's all his work. So God was merciful when we deserved judgment. God loved us when we hated him. Being rich in love, it says. God's love is the motivation for his mercy. Listen, I can't even begin to tell you the hardest job I've ever done is being a parent. It really is. I have the two greatest kids you could have ever imagined. They are just wonderful boys. They're adults now. You would just love to meet them. They're such great guys. The thing I hated most about being a parent is having to discipline them. One of my boys once did something kind of aggressive with the car, and a sane parent would take away the car for 2 weeks, you know, when he was a teenager. A sane parent. But I loved him so much. I just didn't want to do it. I didn't want to hurt him. I didn't want to make his life hard. And I showed him mercy. Now, I didn't always do that because I told him if he ever did it again, he'd never drive the car. That was the thing I said. But I think my love for him made me want to show him mercy. Because all teenagers do stupid stuff. I was a teenager. I can outdo them. The point of it is God is like that parent who loves us so much. He doesn't want to judge us. He wants to show us mercy. So we're saved by his mercy. We're saved by his love. God made us alive or revived us when we were dead. God revived us. Look at what it says in verse 5. Let's see if I can see it. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. God made us alive when we were dead. Imagine a corpse right up here in this room, right? Imagine a corpse, a room full of corpses. We're all corpses. Then in an instant, God comes in, makes us alive. That's better than Miracle Max. That's what God has done for us when we trusted that Jesus died for our sins and rose again. God made us alive. God exalted us, it says in verse 6, when we were lowly. This is how much God is acting on our behalf. He exalted us when we were lowly. This is all the way he made us alive. Look at verse 6. It says, he raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Messiah Jesus. He raised us up with him. When we trusted in Jesus, he took us. We were in the pits, and he took us and raised us up with him. I thought of Chronicles of Narnia, where it talks about the horse and his boy, where Shasta is raised by this wicked fisherman who wants to sell him into slavery. And at the end of the story, I'm going to give you a little spoiler alert here. Close your ears if you've never read it. But at the end of the story, he finds out he's the son of the king, and he's exalted as the heir to the throne. That's what he finds out. What we have done is we are in the pits, and he exalted us with Messiah. Because we are related to the Messiah, just as Shasta was related to the king, just as we are related to the Lord Jesus, we're exalted with him. That's how God made us alive. How did he do it? He showed us mercy, he loved us, he revived us, and exalted us when we were lowly. Isn't that great news? It's just amazing. Why did he do this? If God made us alive, God's work made us alive, also God's purpose was his glory. Look at verse 7. Verse 7 says, I'm waiting for my new glasses, guys. Verse 7, so that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards you in Christ Jesus. In the coming ages, he wanted to show the immeasurable riches of his grace. We tend to think of salvation being centered around us, but it's really centered around God. We don't have a human-centered approach. The point of this is we get the benefit, but who's going to get the glory? God. It's to glorify himself that he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace. That's just remarkable. God wants to turn us into his, and we talked about this in chapter one, eternal trophies of his grace. He's going to have this great trophy room, and we're the ones in there. We're the trophies of his grace. Look at this. Look what I accomplished. And then everyone's going to say, Rydelnik? Look what I accomplished with him. He's the last one I'd expect in here. Eva, we expect that, but him? Yeah, even him. We're going to be trophies of his grace. And so God's purpose was his glory. God's method of making us alive was grace. Remember, he showed us mercy, but he shows us grace. God's method of making us alive was his grace. Look at Ephesians 2:8. I quote this verse probably more than any other verse. Ephesians 2:8, 9. For by grace you have been saved through faith. This is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. God's action, what he wanted to do was save us, deliver us from our own sin, deliver us from judgment. He wanted to grant us eternal life. How does he do it? By grace. If mercy means not getting what we do deserve, grace means getting something we don't deserve. Grace is God giving everything to us when we don't deserve it. Can you imagine if that police officer who pulled me over gave me a ticket and it was $100? He says, how are you going to plead to this, sir? I'm going to plead guilty. I'm guilty. He said, okay. He takes out his wallet. Here's $100. Pay for that ticket. What would that be? He wouldn't have shown me mercy. He would have been giving me something I didn't deserve. He would have been paying for it himself. That would be grace. See? And here's what God did. He showed us mercy and grace. Both. He didn't give us what we did deserve. Instead, he gave us something that we didn't deserve, eternal life with the Lord Jesus. That is just amazing. And it's not through anything we do. It's not through works. How is it done? The instrument he uses is faith. Faith is saying, I'm trusting that God is saying this is true. That's all I'm doing, I'm trusting Jesus. Let me tell you what we have to trust. This is it. Believe this. And I think we all agree. We have to believe that Jesus died for our sins and rose again. This is what faith is. It's our mind. We have to know the fact that Jesus came and died for our sins and rose again, proving he's God. We got to know the facts. That's faith. We've got to believe those facts. We have to have a conviction of its truth. Our need is great, and this is true. This will really save me. It's one thing to know the facts, another thing to have a conviction of it being true. And then, besides that, I have to volitionally accept it. I have to, by will, say, yes, I accept this gift. I have to accept the gift that he has given. Mind, know the facts. Heart, conviction. Will, deciding to trust in him. I don't know if you've ever heard the story. The people out on the Titanic, some people didn't know that there were lifeboats, so they were lost. Other people knew there were lifeboats, they had the facts, but they looked at the dark Atlantic and they thought, that will never save, I can't, those boats can't save me. And they wouldn't get in the boat. And then there were others who said, I know there are boats, and I know that those boats could save me even in the dark Atlantic, but my husband has to stay here on the ship and go down with the ship because it's women and children first. I can't do that. I can't live life without him. I'm not getting in the boat. They had mind, heart, but they did not have will. And then there were some who knew there were boats, knew that they could save them, convinced of it, and got in the boat, and they were delivered. That's what faith is. By grace, through faith. Knowing Jesus died for our sins, convicted that that will really save us, and trusting him, choosing to trust in that alone, that Jesus died for us and rose again. By grace, through faith. It's an offer. It's a gift. It is the gift of God. Some people think faith is the gift. Faith's not the gift. Salvation is the gift. It's saying, will we accept that gift? Yes, we did. Maybe, some of us. I remember there was a guy that was building a deck for Eva and me. And he was a very religious family from a different Christian tradition. And he would come in and have iced tea with me every night after he was working on the deck. And I said to him one day, so if you were to stand before God and ask him, why would I let you into heaven? Why would I forgive your sins? What would you say? He said, well, I try to be really good and I go to church. I said, so you do stuff? He said, yeah. I said, good, let's read this verse. And I showed him Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. And that it's by grace through doing good stuff, right? And he said, no, through faith. I said, yeah, through faith in Jesus that he died for us and rose again. He says, that's what I believe. And at that moment, he trusted Jesus. He accepted the gift. It's God offers us this gift, and through that, we're saved. And I want to, I have to read this because it's from D.L. Moody. D.L. Moody said this about the thief on the cross. The thief had nails through both hands, so he could not work for God. A nail through each foot so that he could not run errands for the Lord. He couldn't lift a hand or a foot toward his own salvation. Yet Christ offered him the gift of God, and he took it. He took it. Christ threw him a passport and took him to paradise. That's not of works. It's only through faith. And his outcome is a masterpiece. Look at verse 10. For we are his workmanship. God is the one that crafted us. Now that we know him, now that our sins are forgiven, we become his workmanship, created beforehand to do good works in Christ Jesus. He created those good works for us, created in Christ Jesus, in Messiah Jesus, for good works which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. The good works are supposed to come out. God makes them. That's what makes us his masterpieces. Good works are the fruit of our salvation, not the root of them. It's the result, not the reason. God prepared everything, even the good works that we're to live in. Isn't that amazing? Yeah, this is all God's work. He did it all, and he gets all the glory. So I'm a baby boomer. You may not have guessed that. And the primary way that I was raised was with the TV set. Here, go watch TV. And in the 60s, I fell in love with reruns of the old 50s Westerns. One of my favorites, Wanted, Dead or Alive. And I love the posters, Wanted, Dead or Alive. You've seen those, haven't you? That's what this is about. God wants us. If we are still dead in trespasses and sins, he wants to make us alive. I don't know, you may be some teenager that came with your parents, kind of dragged along to come to services today, or a friend that got invited. I don't know where you're at. This may be news to you, all the stuff we talked about today. But now you realize that you're still dead in trespasses and sins, still separated from God. God wants to make you alive. You're wanted. He wants you to trust in Jesus. And if any of us here, if we've already become followers of Jesus, what he wants us to do is to walk in those good works that he's made for us. He wants us to live out that masterpiece. If we're already spiritually alive, he wants us to choose the life that is truly life, the abundant life, of living in the good works that he prepared for us, living in obedience to the Lord Jesus. We are wanted by God. whether we're dead right now or alive. He wants us to choose life, whether it's to come to know the Lord Jesus first or to choose the life that he has ordained for us to be his masterpiece. I want you to listen to the song. I'm going to come back. We're going to talk about this a little bit more. But listen to the song because it sets the choice before us right now.
The choice set before you now, living or dying, blessing or cursing. And now the time has come around. Turn from your fighting and rest in his mercy. Choose life that you might live, the life that he gives you forever. Choose life the way that is true from the one who chose you. Father in heaven, choose life. Trust the Lord with all your heart, with all of your soul, and all of your being. Hold on, listen and obey.
Just a blessing to you. I love this book and I pray that you were really impacted by the word. We want to invite you to come back next Sunday at 9 or 11 Central Time. And if you're ready or when you're ready, if you live in the Chicagoland area, we sure would love to see you at one of our campuses. Well, as you go into your week, I pray that you'll remember every minute of every day that you are loved.